Welcome everyone to this Force Friday. Today we are going to talk about hair, right? A thing that we all care about, unless of course you're bald and you have no concerns over your hair. Hair is a funny thing, you know, it's so organic, right? It's just so organic. And what we're gonna try to do is try to control that organicness and get a sense of design and force and form and shape. And how do we bring all those fundamentals of what we instruct in this force drawing approach over to the idea of hair itself. And it matters, you know, it's like in character design, it's really, really important, right? Hairstyles are a very important part of a character, just as it is for each one of us. You know, I know what I look like in the morning, my hair like standing tall, especially right now, it's really long. So it's like really high up, you know, I almost look like Heat Miser or the bad guy from like The Incredibles. You know, and if I were to walk around like that all day long, that would give people a different impression of me, right? It's like, wow, this guy's even more crazy or chaotic, right? So versus the hairstyle I have now, which is way more tame or controlled, right? So what does that look like? What does it say about the person? Important, right? And we want to try to get to appeal. There's this idea of appeal again, like appealing shape design. How does that work? How do you create appealing hairstyles because of that, you know? Yeah, I think Swanley Mutunji and I, if we wanted, we could probably open up a hair salon and get some good looks coming out of that. So let's get to it, right? Let's say hello to our force instructors. How you doing, Mutunji?
I'm doing good. I just combed my hair yesterday, so I'm
very good. Yeah, I know I'm due for a haircut. I'm getting this this whole thing going on back here. So next week, we'll be here. Next Friday, you'll see me with a shorter do. Yeah. How are you doing, Swanley?
Good. Good. I was just thinking, I like the thumbnail. You know, hair, the thumbnail. Yeah. And it reminded me how much, I don't know if you saw the Wonder Woman from 2009, the animated film. But yeah, I kept thinking, yeah, the hair design is just amazing. You know, it's just one big shape, but it's so forceful and fluid. Mm-hmm. Like that is, when you talk about like appealing hair, that's the number one example that comes to mind. So yeah, it makes an impact, you know, if designed correctly.
Yeah, and two things pop to my mind. One is, you know, we all want Prell commercial hair, right? Like just really beautiful hair, especially women usually have long hair. You want, like, hair shows, what does hair show? It shows health, right? If I'm out and just kind of walking around, I see someone with like crazy frizzy hair. It's different if you can tell that somebody's got that frizzy hair because that's the style, they're purposely doing that. Or if it just feels like it's not taken care of, you know? And then, you know, our quick judgment kind of kicks up, just like, oh, they're not taking care of themselves, not taking care of the hair. What else are they not taking care of, right? And I'm not saying that's accurate, but what I am saying is that's how we start to think, right? It's like we start making quick judgments about it, you know? And that's why there's commercials for stuff like Prell, where people have hair like the illustration behind me, where it's like long and silky smooth. And you can tell whoever shot it, you know, has a certain light on the hair, like the highlights, you know, on the back of this girl's hair over here. You know, like all these, this beautiful sheen, right, that goes across the hair also, right? It's all these things that show healthy hair, you know? And we're going to look at different styles of artists today too, and how they handled hair. It's, like I said, it comes back to appeal, you know? It's funny because I was looking at, I didn't bring her in today, but I was looking at Moana from Disney, for instance. She's got more like crazy curly hair. And I was like, oh, I wonder how they drew that, you know? And it was kind of sketched with more scribbly lines. So it's a little off the beaten path from what Disney would normally actually do. Usually the stuff's very controlled and maintained. You know, with Moana, they let that go loose. I think because 3D is allowed for that. You know, this 3D technology goes all the way back to Brave, basically at Pixar, because the main character's hair was just so massive and red and crazy and curly. They had to like bump up the hair technology, and that same hair technology that was a Pixar for Brave is what was moved over to Disney Animation. And then they started using and improving again for Tangled, of course, right? Because then there was just lots of hair, right? An overabundance of hair that they had to, you know, learn how to animate. So, But we'll get into, like I said, we'll get into all of that further today as we go through our conversation. We have a very exciting lineup. You know, Swenly's going to start off with sort of do's and don'ts and like what's good and step-by-step instruction of how to design hair. I'm going to go over a bunch of different aesthetics of hair and different artists. And then Ritenje is going to follow up with some demonstrations for us of actually drawing the hair. So sit back, relax, watch. If, again, you're enjoying what you're seeing here on this channel, then please hit the subscribe button and hit the bell for notifications so you know what we're doing every week. We will be here again, obviously, next Friday with another interesting Force Friday for you guys. Okay. So Swanley, take it away whenever you're ready.
Okay. Let's see. Share screen. So force hair, I think a lot of you guys might have requested this in the past. So it's finally here. So how do you approach it, right? So let's start with a little step-by-step. And of course, if you're delving into any new subjects, it's a wise decision to start simple. So I just took a reference with relatively simple haircuts to start with. Now, before you get to the hair, of course, the hair sits on the head. So you need a good, well-constructed head to begin with. You know, so make sure that you learn your perspective and how to construct the heads. And then we just start with our basic model here, our basic head drawing, which is bald, as you see. So how do you approach it, right? How do you map out the hair? Like what you don't want to do, which is something that beginning artists do. I know I did it for sure at the beginning, is go in there and then just try to draw every single hair strand. You know, this is going to end up looking not so appealing, and it's going to take a lot of work. You know, plus, I mean, my brought up animation, if you're working in animation and you just draw all those individual hair strands, it's not going to work, because imagine an animator having to sit down and draw every hair strand of the character for all the frames. That's going to be a crazy amount of work and not that efficient. So what we want to do is we want to start with the simple shapes of the hair. Now, for a short haircut like this, I normally like to start with some kind of hairline. Like here, we don't actually see the hairline on the forehead. So I just start with something simple. Just from like constructional logic, I know that the hair is going to wrap around the top of the head. You know, then it's going, we can see like the hairline here at the sides, and we can see the sideburn. So what's happening here, not that big of a deal. I just need to know that, hey, this is going to wrap around. So this gets us started. And the next step was to look at the big shapes. Now, what stood out for me was like this big chunk of hair here at the top. You know, and of course, it's not just a flat shape, it also has form. So when I'm dealing with hair, like I deal with shape and form like simultaneously, you know, because form creates shape, and the shape that we see has volume in it. So they kind of work hand in hand. So I drew the top part of his hair, and notice that I also added some, let me change the color. I also added some wrapping lines, meaning that I'm aware that, hey, the hair has volume. You know, again, it's not just like paper thin. It has mass, it has volume on top of his head. So hey, I drew some.
Could you take that layer and knock the transparency down like 30 or 50% for a second?
Which layer?
The hair layer.
You mean the drawing?
Yeah, unless it's all combined. Is that for the hair layer separate?
It is all combined, yeah.
Oh, okay. My point here is, you know, one thing for you guys to keep in mind that I know I used to make the mistake on when I was drawing is, like Swenley's saying, there's thickness. And if we could see through that purple hair shape, you know, you would see the edge of the skull, right? And like, how high is the hair off the head, right? At that contoured edge, like how thick is it actually, right? It's something to be aware of. It's very easy to make the hair too thin, like hair thin, right? Versus actually giving it some volume, right?
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good point indeed. Like, again, keep in mind the hair is not paper thin. It has some volume to it. So you need to take into consideration that, you know, if we continue the heads, like the top of its cranium is not going to be here. You know, it's going to be like more down here, and there is thickness or volume for the hair. So the hair itself has volume and mass to it. Now, same for the part of the back. You know, his cranium is literally like touching the back edge of his hair. This cranium would be like more back here, you know, and there would be some space because, again, the hair has volume. So, yeah, that was the first step. And even here, talking about volume, I mean, I could even think about this as having a turning edge, meaning that, you know, we have a top plane, and here we start going to the side plane. You know, so if we outline it here, and like, there are like these two big curls here that I included in the simple shape. Now, so we think about this, again, this has volume, it's round. So it means that at some point we go from the top plane and we start going to the side plane. You know, so there is, if we relate this to a box, there would be a corner right there. Now, again, so very important, like Mike mentioned, keep in mind the volume of the hair. And so next I added the shape at the sides. You know, and again, even this, it has some volume to it. It's not completely flat, so that's why you see me drawing these simple cross contour lines. You know, we could even continue it here. And notice again that my focus is on the simple shapes. You know, I'm using straight lines and curved lines to deliberately design those shapes. Now, given the hair is pretty simple, but I'm still omitting like the hair strands that you see up here. No, that's not important at this point. Just look for the overall big shapes. You know, I even took the liberty to like exaggerate the shape of the hair back there just to make it a bit more interesting. You know, otherwise it's just this long line here. So I wanted to break it up a little bit to add some contrast and interest in that area. And after that, I took the time to shape out the hair. Now, it could be, you can go more complex than this, but I kept it simple to primarily show that you don't need a lot of detail to make the hair look good. You know, especially if you're designing for something like animation, the simpler you can go, the better. Now, if we look at like comic books, there would be like more details in there. And even then, if someone has a short haircut like this, you know, you want to be efficient and keep it to simple shapes. And notice again, I didn't just copy all the hair strands. I went in here and I made sure to design those shapes. Again, you have two tools to design with. You have a straight line, you have a curved line, and you have every extreme in between. If there are any questions, of course, feel free to state those in the chat.
Yeah, we had one that I'm answering right now. Dark Knight said, what if the hair is the same thickness on all sides of the head? Do you still think of the hair on the top of the plane of the head as a separate shape? Now, I was just basically saying, you know, it depends really, first of all, if there's a part or not in the hair, right? Because that part, mm-hmm, could define, you know, different shapes, right? I guess this question too is, you know, you could break up the shapes based on the planes and say, I'm going to make a shape for the top plane of the head and then the sides and so on. You know, that would be another way of breaking it up if you wanted.
Yeah, that's a good question. And I think based on that question, I think it's important to say that at the end of the day, like I'm just showing you one way to approach it, but you have to use your problem solving skills because depending on the hairdo, it's going to be a different approach. You know, not every approach is effective for different hairstyles. So it's good to have like a general approach, but like every hairdo is going to be its own problem. So you have to think about what's effective and how to approach it to get good results.
I mean, your hair is like a great beginning point, right? So the hair is all of one thickness. And it's really just a shape on your head, right? It's like one smooth, simple shape. It's like the longer the hair gets, you know, it's like wearing clothes, like skin versus a tight piece of clothing versus loose clothing. It's same with hair. It's like a bald head, it's one kind of haircut versus a longer hairstyle, you know, and being aware of how those shapes basically flow out of the skull and if there's a part or not a part, you know? Yeah,
indeed. So this is a simple hairstyle. And then I challenge myself with a more complex one. So with this one, of course, when you look at this, it can be overwhelming. It's like, how are you going to show all those curls, you know, and all the texture of the hair? And still, again, keep it appealing, you know, and clear. So for this one, I also started with a base sketch. I wanted the head to be a bit more three-quarter view and a different, from a slightly different angle, which I found more interesting. So I sketched out the base heads. And similar to the previous one, I did actually start with the widow's peak here. You know, right in the middle. I was like, okay, I have the center line of the heads. So I can start here and I can start shaping this out. Now, so the corner of the head is important because there's where you go from the top plane to the side plane. So we need to make sure that we take that corner here. And of course, the other one is going over and behind the forehead. So I started by shaping this out actually. And once I reached the ear, I was like, well, this is all like one big shape, you know, coming down into that curl. So I just continued, you know, shaping that out. And again, these curls are volume. So I treated them as like forceful cylinders, meaning that I'm aware that this is our rounds, you know, same for the curls on the farther side. And then it was the task of breaking this down. Again, the hair sits on the head. So I know that we have a top part, which is like around here. Now, so now I'm relating the hair to a box. You know, I'm looking for plane changes. Now, so this goes up and around here, we go from this front plane and we go to the top plane. So, okay, I can see this. And this is all the front plane. Now it's like this big arc coming down and it ends about here. And this continues. Now this one actually kind of like starts to merge into that curl. And then here we go from this front plane to the side plane. Now, so I'm visualizing the volume. No, and given that I drew the heads from a slightly different angle, so I had to use my imagination to kind of like get this volume in that new angle. Well, this is what I was thinking about, you know, in terms of the simple form, and then bring that over here and making sure that the shape is forceful. Like I could have easily gone and made both sides of the hair perfectly symmetrical, but wouldn't be as appealing, you know? So notice that we have this big curve over here and this side is straighter in contrast. So once I had that big form, it's a nice start, but then the next question was, how am I going to define the texture? So I started actually around here, and I started like drawing like the simpler, bigger shapes. And then I was like, okay, those curls are actually, well, first of all, the hair, these hair shapes can be seen as ribbons. Now, so if you think of a simple ribbon like this, now you would have, let's clear this up, when you would have like a highlights most of the time on that ribbon. And then I thought, well, those curls are kind of like if you take these ribbons and you turn those ribbons into cylinders, you know, so you can think of a cylinder. And then this all like wrapping around. And then I was like, okay, this is a good way to break it down. But of course, I don't want those cylinders to be perfectly symmetrical. I want the shape of the cylinder to be forceful. So I will need some sort of straight to curve design in that cylinder. Now, so this is already looking better. And then it's a matter of breaking down this cylinder into parts, meaning showing how the ribbon is like, it's like wrapping around. And again, even in this, I want to bring some variety. Now, so that's how I started to add these parts like here. So in certain parts, like the ribbons are like simpler, like you can see like around here, for example, we have this hair, which is then creating this curl. And in other parts it's more cylindrical, you know, based on what I saw in the reference. So again, it's problem solving. You know, I don't recall ever drawing this hairstyle before. So I had to think, you know, and use my artistic skills to figure out how to get this particular texture of the hair in the simple shape that I started with.
Hey, before you move forward, I want to show one thing in here.
Sure.
One thing, what's cool about this drawing on the left that Swinley has is now we can see through the hairstyle. And talking about force shape, what you're doing is you're like, this is the edge of the head. So you're actually able to not only make all the shapes of the curls and stuff and the big shape of the hair, but you can push it against the shape of the skull, right? So you'll notice Swinley's, the edge here is offset from the edge of the skull. And notice over here, right, the top, this goes from narrow to wide, right? So the shape is like skull versus hair is like this, right? So that makes, again, like another four shape. You'll notice here, we have this straight versus this shape, right? So you're shaping, you know, through the hair against the skull to get a sense of what the design is of the shape compared to the head, you know, kind of offsetting. So instead of being parallel, right, what we're trying to stay away from is, you know, Swanley could have made this much more boring and basically, you know, let me grab a different color here and said, let me make the hair go exactly at the shape of the head, right? So here I'm going parallel to this blue to this blue, for instance, and said, you know, I'm going to make the hair like this. Let's go over to the top. I'm going to make it parallel to the top, right? And done this. And then over here, let's just make it parallel to this, right? And made it look like this, right? See, so that's not what we want. We're looking for these kind of straight to curve shapes, or you can think of them as like pinched triangles, basically, right? To help push the design, right?
Yeah, talking about design, I mean, when drawing this hair, it just reminded me that design is just a matter of patience and thinking. You know, it's easy to, like I said, just rush to the drawing and just draw mindlessly. But with design, you need to take time to think and look at the shapes, you know, and evaluate the shapes. Is the shape forceful and appealing? And if not, redesign the shape so it is. You know, I think that's often a step that students miss. They just draw and then they post the drawing, like, here's the drawing, give me feedback. But I'm like, did you check the drawing for the rules of shape design? So very important, you know, take your time to think and make conscious design decisions to make the drawing appealing. So this is what I have. I'm going to hand it over to Mike.
All right. Let's see here. Let's head back to Photoshop, folks. So force hair, right? For my segment, what I'm going to do is I'm going to share with you different styles of different artists and trying to prove out how important this concept of forceful shape actually is in hair with volume and so on, right? So let's take a look, right? This will be fun. It all starts here, right? So I'm going to kind of go backwards. I'm going to start with reality and then go into art, okay? So believe it or not, this is really what we want when we're designing artistically, you know, hair for comic books, animation, character design, what have you. It's this kind of like chunkiness, right? What you don't want to do is like have somebody's head, and this is what somebody who's just starting off, like Swenley said before, will do is just draw like lots of hair. It's like, here's hair, you know, like this is where everyone starts, right? It's like, I want to draw hair. And it's like lots of lines, right? Because you think hair, right? Your goal is, when you're younger, you know, you think every line is a hair, right? So I'm going to draw hair. And what you've learned and what we're going over today is we're gravitating towards, no, what we want to do is we want to take hair as volume, as Swenley mentioned, right? And turn that into shapes and volumes, right? So when we get to real hair, what we're really looking at is, you know, number one is like, what is this shape, right? She has very appealing hair shape. So why do I say that? Well, because it's got a lot of this kind of like fat, wide space to, a narrower triangle, right? And there's flow that can go in this. It has the forceful shape. And if you're interested in that, check out the other videos or drawingforce.com or the books, what have you. We talk about this in nauseam, right? Like this is what so much of it's about, right? So you can see if we go into her hairstyle, it's a very pixie-like hairstyle. She's got these like chunks, like this chunk here, not so great, right? If I had to design it, you could see this is a little bit symmetrical. Right? Why? Well, because over here, like pushes in like that. I would, if I were designing this, right? Here, let me grab black. I would just push the curve more over here and the straight like this for this shape, right? You see? And then here, this would be like a shape, right? So now I've got this shape to this shape, right? And this is a great shape she's got going on here. And then I can break that shape up into smaller triangles, you see? But this is what we're looking for, you know. This is what ends up being out there in art nowadays when it comes to character design. Is you'll notice her hair automatically wants to work like this. I'm pretty much tracing the photograph. You see, it's got a lot of these triangular, straight to curve shapes in it, right? So that's what we're doing. You know, here this gets a little more intricate, right? Because here on this wig, anytime you see an S like this, right, it's really like two forceful shapes. So you have this one, which goes like this. You got this straight to curve, and then it flips it, and you got it over here. So I'm going to move this over in white so you can see it. All right, so you can see over here, it's two forceful shapes, shape number one and shape number two, right? So there's two straight to curves there to get through that. You also want to be aware of like, what is the shape on this edge compared to this edge? So look, there's a big triangle, right? And then it comes in like this and it creates this nice little pinch down here. So this is a cool shape, right? That big shape, right? So again, like Swanley was saying, you know, it takes like this real level of cognitiveness on your end to be aware of like what's going on, you know, how am I designing the shape? It's very easy to fall into the trap of symmetry. This is not so great, right? From here to here, I look at it just as a silhouette and I'm like, you know, her hair does this, not so good, right? I would, if I can design this and control it, I'm gonna try to offset that. Maybe I'll push the curve here and allow this to be straighter and then push that curve down here. So it's asymmetrical and then I can get myself back into a forceful shape because of that, right? So I'm manipulating the design to get these different forces out of it, right? I just want you to be aware that this cartoon stuff isn't baloney, like it comes from somewhere. Here it is. When anyone gets a hairstyle like this or they get the coloring in it like this, notice it creates this like banding, right? And this banding is awesome because it allows you to see these shapes again, right? So we come over to this haircut, you know, I could see this shape. It's like shape one, shape two, shape three, four, five, right? So all these different shapes. And they're long and thin, but they're still forceful shapes, right? You look at this photograph right? It's really beautiful, right? The shaping, right? Like, look at that. There's my straight to curve. And then it's going to reverse itself down at the bottom. So I'll have a straight on the left and curve on the right. And I get this really nice flow, right? And to state the obvious, it has form, it has volume, it's on her head, right? It has thickness, not super thick, not super high, but it's on her head. If I could see through her head, through her hair, I should say, you know, it looks like her skull's about right there. It's probably about right here somewhere, right? So this is all hair, right? This is like the width of the hair. So you want to be aware of that. Don't stick the hair right down on top of the head, right? Like, give it some lift off of the head, off the head, so it's got some volume, some thickness to it. This idea of banding is a big deal. We're going to talk more about this in other artwork I'm going to show you, but banding is really great. Why is that? Because instead of just being one flat shape, this banding allows us to show volume, right? It gives us volume. If I had a ball, you know, and it's just like this, it's flat. But as soon as I do this and I put a line in there, it immediately gives us volume, right? So these lines in the hair shape gives me volume of the hair, lets me wrap it around the head more, right? So it starts here. I want you to be aware it's not baloney, right? It's hair. It starts with real hair, right? This is where these ideas come from. So now we start looking at artists. It's like, well, son of a gun, look at that. Like, look at these beautiful shapes, right? This is JC Leyendecker. Again, for those of you who don't know who this is, so JC Lion is spelled like this, Leyendecker. Long since, you know, past 1900s, early 1900s. But look at how he's shaped, right? Look at the shaping. It's like, look at this shape. Look at this. Look at this. Look at this, right? Look at this. Look at how things are shaped out, right? And he's getting structure in there too. You can feel that, right? Feel the construction of that. Feel the construction in here. But he's designing the heck out of this, right? Designing the heck out of it. Really beautiful. And you can see that that aesthetic, of course, is getting pushed across everything he's drawing here. The hat, look at how he designed like her profile, right? Like, it's all structured out like that. So the hair is not going to escape, you know, Leyendecker's sense of style, right? It's in there, right? It's going to be in there too, right? And what, you know, why am I showing this? Well, because he creates beautiful art. It's really appealing. And it's because he's using forceful shape design to get to this space, right? Here's another Leyendecker. Look at these, you know, these different hairstyles, right? Look at this boy's hair, so cool. Almost feels like ribbon, like shiny ribbon, right? Like, look here, you know, we've got like this shape, right? To this, right? And then that shape is cut up into these smaller shapes, right? Remember we talked about like the ribbons. Here, Leyendecker is just pushing in these lines. It's not like the kid's hair has been colored, right? And has those bands, but he still creates bands, right? Look at this shape here. Big, straight, huge curve, right? Big straight to curve shape design. And then it's broken up with smaller straight to curve shapes with each one of these shapes, right? So, man, you can't get any better than that. It's like forced shape all over the place, this abstraction of shape design and all the hair. It's in the nose, it's in the eye, you know, it ends up everywhere. Look at the fluidity in the fingers, curve to straight, right? I don't wanna get too much off subject, but it's exciting to see like how much he's pushing that across everything. We're in hair today, but it's all over the place, right? Again, look at this girl's hair. So Leyendecker doesn't typically draw like flow like this. He draws flow like this. He adds a little bit more pointedness to it, a little more choppy, right? So look at that and how it tucks in here like this. It's got this sort of feel of what I call zippiness. It's like chunk, 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 you know, like chops from one side to another because it pushes itself through these angles, right? Look at that shape, right? It's all these like awesome shapes that he ends up putting into his designs, right? So, and I'm not saying you have to be as choppy as Leyendecker, but I want you to be aware of that forceful shape, the appeal of it, and how someone like Leyendecker is using it. Now, we can say that, you know, that this style, you know, Leyendecker now is pretty prevalent. You know, when I was teaching in the mid 90s and I brought up JC Leyendecker, most students didn't know. This is pre-internet, right? Most of you probably know who JC Leyendecker is at this point, right? And because of that prevalence, because of the internet, I think it's really helped everyone create better hair, quite honestly, right? So this is illustration from League of Legends. right? And here it is again. Look at how much this is all straight to curve shape design, right? I mean, look, it's like one, two, here's a big one, three, right? So you'll see that's the big shape. And then that shape's broken down into smaller shapes, right? There it is, there it is, there it is, there it is. It's done in chunks, right? Keep this idea in mind of chunks, right? Not hairs, not strands of hair. Hair is done in chunks, right? And that allows you to help design it and get more flow out of it, right? Let's see, any questions so far? When I draw hair, it looks like a poorly worn wig. Yeah, so the trick there is just to make sure that you're thinking about seams and how it's connected to the head. It seems like hems because I don't think of the skull. Yep. Nick, I'm 30 minutes behind on the video, so hello from the past. I'm sure everyone is saying hello from the past or welcome to the future. So chunks, right? Chunks of hair. You could see it in the girl over here in the back. You could see even in the beginning over here. And then that takes us to the show that we all loved, right? Arcane. So they took this aesthetic of paint and turned it into a 3D animated show. If you haven't seen this, I highly recommend watching it. One of the most expensive, just rich shows that's ever been created, quite honestly, when it comes to animation. I want to say it was $30 million for every episode. It's like insanely high cost, you know, compared to film or other shows of this, of like a 3D animated show. So you're going to see some of the highest quality you've ever seen artistically in a show like this. So definitely go check it out. My point here again is look at the chunking now, right? It's like, look at this shape, right? Look at these shapes, right? Everything is chunked out. Look at this long straight to curve. Look at this straight to curve, right? Look at this, the seam, right? Compared to this shape, okay? But all these like straight to curve shape designs, right? Even when the hair is, you know, more prel-like and long and full like this, you still have those breaks in the hair, right? If I zoom in on this, you can see the breaks in there. So that helps give it volume instead of just being one big shape. But we don't want to get to the point where we're just drawing singular hairs. You know, here you can see they start breaking that down to give it a little bit of texture, right? To make it feel like it's like that. But it's really about these bigger shapes, right? Bigger straight to curve shape design. So where does that take us? It takes me to comics. I brought these in. These are Walt Simonson, who happens to be one of my favorite comic book artists. Totally different aesthetic that he did here in the hair, right? So you can see here, it has a little bit. He went for the shapes, he went for the banding, right? It's got forceful shape in it. Feels kind of organic because I like that he put a couple of little like loose strands in there like we all would normally have. And then here's another drawing. So shapey, but more curly, more fluid, right? Like immediately that changes the feel of the hair, right? Like curlier fluid hair versus stiffer, more shaped out hair, right? That brings me to, here, let me spell this out for you before we get to the next guy. So this is Simonson, in case any of you like what you're seeing. Simonson, Walt, right? Amazing, amazing comic book artist. He basically did the Thor stuff that you're seeing in the theaters today are from stories that Walt Simonson drew in like the late 80s. Yeah, so if you look up Thor in the late 80s with like Betty Ray Bill, Walt Simonson stuff, amazing, right? This is Joseph Scott Campbell. So you can look him up as J. Scott Campbell. Joseph Scott Campbell. He was most famous for a comic book called Danger Girl. That was in the 90s, and he's still around today, you know, doing well. He's into making maquettes and such now also. But man, he's got this thing down pat. This idea of, you know, good shape design and appeal. I don't think this guy knows how to make an ugly drawing. You know, like it's just not in him anymore. Like everything that comes out is just super appealing, really nice and fluid, excellent shape design. You know, he does it in the eyes. He does it in his line. I've seen him like clean up his drawings. He'll take a line like this and say, well, I'm going to make that a straight to curve line by designing it. He'll actually go in and design the line, the ink line, and then fill it like this. So now it's more of a straight to curve shape in the line, right? Versus doing this. Okay. So that's how maniacal he is about his attention to detail of shape, right? And he's doing it here with the hair. This is a great example too, what I was saying before with Swenley's, you know, like be aware of the volume of the hair. So we could see the skull here. And we can see the hair, you know, sitting off of that. So it's a little parallel here, but then you can see he kind of like pinches down and sweeps up, right? So he's got this curve versus this curve versus this curve. So it's like 1, 2, 3, right? Then this comes down, 4. Then he cuts in again, 5, right? So it's this snapping back and forth, very J.C. Leyendecker-like, right? Very J.C. Leyendecker. And you'll notice the shapes he's making, right? So here's the breaks that we were talking about, right? Nice fluid breaks in the hair, chunks, folks, right? Chunks of hair, really beautiful. So J. Scott Campbell. And that translates over to the sculptures and maquettes that he ends up making, right? So here's an Alice in Wonderland done by Joseph Scott Campbell. And you can see over here in the hair, that's translating, right? Into three-dimensional space, right? We get this really nice shaping. Look at the curl, look at that. That's two straight to curve shapes. Remember what I did before, 1 and 2, right? Notice these curls all have these like beautiful S-ing moments in them. And plus, you know, if you do this with a shape and then you add line into it that crosses over, it makes it feel like it's wrapping around it, right? It's giving it like a rotation. You're getting rotation within that shape, which is also beautiful, right? So there's J. Scott Campbell. We've seen him go from line to 3D. I brought this in. Here's a nice marker illustration that he did of Rapunzel, right? And where did this come from? Of course, this is inspired by this, right? So these are, I think this is Jin Kim, if I'm not mistaken, right? He did, so this is from the movie Tangled. We have Flynn and we have Rapunzel on the right. And notice the shape design. Notice the separation in the hair. Notice a strong angle here. So he really blocks out the construction of the head using the hair to get that sharp angle in there, right? And then over here, notice the very clear center of the widow's peak. So that's something I use when I'm drawing a lot. I usually will have most of my characters have their break in the middle, or across the eye, I'll split that distance in half and put it on a third, right? Like my personal hair part's on the side, right? So that I'll divide that across the width of the hair or the middle of the face, right? So those are two great breaks to go for. And they're very mathematical. They're very fractional, right? Easy to get in there, right? I love the way in the Rapunzel drawing, you know, you really get a sense of that thickness too. It's like sweeping up and around. You can see underneath there. So it feels like it's got some heft to it, right? Some volume. And then you can see even in this very light sketch here, this one might be Keane. Yeah, I think this one is probably Glenn's. I think this is Glenn Keane's, and this one is probably Jin Kim over here. Look at just even in him just noodling, you know, like just sketching this stuff off so loosely, it still has good shape design to it, right? Notice the attention in both of these drawings to the back of the head. Notice the fat line there, the darker black line, to say, you know what, even with this hair, I can feel her hair resting on the back of her skull here and their structure there, right? So that's a kind of cool little design thing that's going on between these two guys, right? You really feel that black line, you know, hugging the skull and the angle here to give us perspective. And these things matter, you know, because when you're drawing something over and over again, you want to get a sense of the rules, right? The rules of the character. So here we have this, we have this break here, then we have this come up. You have these breaks in here. Again, notice the shape design, right? Notice the breaks in the hair we talked about. By the way, if you want a beautiful male, you always have to have hair hanging in the face, just a given, right? So here it's actually pushed to his sides a little bit, but most hair usually goes over the face. And when it goes over the face, so here's a face, right? Here's eyes. Again, break in the middle, let's say. It's a great pointer, right? You have the hair kind of point to the eye. Notice that little trick, right? It's like, oh, I'm going to point it in, right? Maybe this one's a little higher, the other one's a little lower, but the hairstyle is like pointing it. Even on Rapunzel, notice it covers her face, right? It goes over her, over part of her face. That's always a little like beauty trick. Now, what's funny here is look at the hairstyle here and boom, guess what? Same hairstyle, right? So Flynn and Simba have exact same style over 15 years worth of time, right, between these two films. And we still have the centered break and the hair that comes up and over. Oh, well, son of a gun, look at that. It's pointing right at that eye, isn't it? Right. So they'll try to push that into the style, into the hairstyle. It's also appealing because it's shaggy. It's like in his face. It's kind of the, you know, the rebel character, the sort of romantic male we'll have it like in the face, right? So, you know, and notice the hair really does feel like it has structure here, right? If I zoom in here, grab black, you know, I come up here like this and I come up here to here, I feel like there's a front plane going on here. You see like this, and then over here is the skull and there's an underneath, right? So there's volume, there is volume, but there's also this sense of like, what's the shape design? Now, one trick I learned down at Disney is they do this a lot. Anytime there's like breaks in somebody's hair, especially on corners. So let's say, you know, I draw somebody's hairstyle like this. Here like this, right? Anywhere where there's a break, like that corner, that's where usually you'll have a couple of tufts of hair. You'll do this like 1, 2, 3 thing, right? Like here, he's got a couple more. And you can see there's lots of notes here. Cheek hairs curve away from the face and connect to the mane. Note the gap between the cheek line and the sphere of the cranium. That's this shape right here. But also when you're breaking up the hair itself like this, you want to create like asymmetry. So notice the bottoms are all very different from one another in height. And so are the indents. You see the indents are different. And then the widths are different. Notice I made this one medium, small, and wide. Right? That was very planned. I did this very quickly in my head as I was drawing that. I'm breaking up all this asymmetry, right? You see? So lots of different things going on there, right? And like I said, usually at the breaks is where you have, like here, right here on his chin, you know, I could easily put in, like, let me put a couple of tufts right there of hair, right? It might be here, you see? So that's where, you know, like here and here, right? Any of these, like, peak moments are usually where you'll have those, like, little tufts of hair going on, okay? So here's one of the queens of hair, right? At least from the Disney universe would have been Pocahontas. She's the one with the prel hair I was talking about. So what I love about this is the design, right? Like, look at how Glen Keane really pushed for crazy shape design here in the hair. Like, it had a life of its own, right? In fact, I want to share with you a little treat. Most of you probably have not seen. I don't know if this is on the internet either. So this is a rare opportunity here. I have this. This is from when there was laser discs, right? The really big discs, they were like size of 33 albums, like the huge albums. So I'm going to watch this with you. This is Glen Keane doing one of his first like animation tests for Pocahontas, right? We'll go through the whole thing because it's not that long. So you can see here, she's running. Now remember, this is the three-dimensionality and she's going to run towards camera. That's done through drawing, right? So this is done through Glen making the drawings of her bigger and bigger. But look at that hair, man, right? Look at this beautiful prel hair, like bouncing and flowing. Look at the weight of it, right? She pulls it out from her head like that. Just spectacular. Now, Glen has done talks about where he looked, guess what, at J.C. Leyendecker. He looked at J.C. Leyendecker for this, right? For the film in general, the design aesthetic of the whole movie. I love this one moment here. Like, look at the shapes. Hold on. Look at the shapes of the hair, right? As she's running and she gets over here to this pose position. Look at the shapes, right? Just amazing. Beautiful, forceful shapes. Look at that flow right there. You see that? It's like ribbons, right? Beautiful ribbons of hair. Now, I love this moment right here. She takes this hair. Notice that straight to curve shape design, right? Man, so clear, just so graphic. And then notice here, he's going to take it. He throws her hair out right here. So notice the rhythm, straight to curve shape. And then it explodes. He makes it pop. Boom, right there, right? So I love that like toss out of one clean kind of snake-like shape and then the pop and explosion of the fan at the end of these straight to curves, right? Each one of these is a straight to curve in itself. Notice the big straight to curve, the weight of her hair. And then lastly is look at these great shapes he draws as she pulls it out. Man, look at that. It's like a cobra's hood, right? Coming out the sides. And look at the design of that, right? The straight to curves in there are just spectacular. And the timing of the weight of the drop, right? Just makes her hair feel luxurious and heavy, right? So here, I'll play this one little section real quick. Now you've seen some of those frames. Look at how they play out. Pop, right? And then drops down. And again, drops down, right? Nice and heavy. Just amazing. I mean, such high level of skill of draftsmanship being brought over, you know, and design being brought over to animation, right? You're basically watching Linedecker animated. Like, it doesn't get much better than that, folks. So I close my segment with a return to kind of a quasi, you know, quasi reality. And that is that here we are. Now we're back at 3D films at something like Disney Animation. And you'll notice even here, right, we started off with pictures of real women with their hairstyles. And here we are rendering in a realistic hair, you know, in a realistic style. You can see this really looks like hair. But guess what? Still straight to curve hair shapes, right, all over the place. That's basically what's going on here, right? Even this little thing she's got going on here is two straight to curve shapes, right? Look at that little thing going on there. It's little curls, right? So inside, you know, inside you can see they've spent their time rendering. So you could see the strands. It adds this level of realism. But what matters more is the shaping. The shaping is what is giving us its appeal, right? So that's it for my segment. I hope that this gives you a sense of, this is not just us talking, like this is a big thing. I've crossed video games. We've looked at League of Legends, one of the most famous games on the planet Earth. We've looked at Disney Animation, one of the biggest animation companies on the planet Earth. And we've looked at J.C. Leindecker, one of the most famous illustrators of all time, right? And we're teaching that same thing. We're trying to teach you guys like, hey, in drawing appealing hair, you want to think about forceful shape design. So I'm going to close out. It's all Mrtunjay is going to do some demoing for you. And then that'll be the end of today's session. All yours, Mrtunjay.
All right. Thanks, Mike.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, let's get to some demoing. So here I have, I just prepared a head drawing, you know, just like Shmeli said, we want to have, just want to have like a well-constructed head. And it's not as, I just like roughly shaped it out, you know, and I have like four hairstyles, you know, that we can like start to put on top of it. Now, maybe not four, you know, I have like a woman head too. So I just want to talk a little bit like more about shapey and like more like long hairs. All right, so let's get into drawing those. Now, the first thing that we got to do, you know, so you basically have this. And you see what I did? I'm just basically focusing on this, like, heart, you know, basically the top, right, which is the, like, the front of the head and, like, the side of the head. Because, you know, what many people do is, like, it's like a helmet, you know, so you really have to, like, think like a helmet. It's basically like this, okay, like a little helmet, and, like, the head is in the middle, okay, like this. So you got to think like that first, like the hair is sitting on top of the head. Okay, you really got to be focused a bit. You really want to focus on like the front and the top and the sides of the head. Okay, you can start something as simple as this, you know, like this child, right? So you see like what's happening, like I usually start with the front, like it's like an arc basically, and you can like go to the side. And see, like, as I'm going through, I'm, like, designing these shapes, even though maybe they are there, maybe they're not there. Again, make sure that you're using this hair, like, for some kind of purpose, right? It's going to be animated or, you know, something like that, okay? And we are, like, really focusing on, like, the shape design of it. So, again, you see, look at the hair texture. Like, it's really furry. It's, like, really dry hair. It's almost like this, like, dry... like utensil cleaner, you know. But what you're gonna have is like, you see like how I'm designing it out. I just like cut that little part in there. You see like that little triangle in there, and then go in there, and there we go. So see, I'm just like wrapping this around it, but it doesn't look as wrapped right now just because the other part, you know, this is like what the mistake that most people do is they forget about the other side of the hair. So see right there, if I just put it like there, that's when it sits, when it completely sits on top of the head, okay? So it's almost like layering, okay? You got like this first layer of the hair, okay? Second layer of the head, and this like little piece in there, which is like this like third layer, okay? So it like brings in the depth, okay? Now the hair is like completely sitting on top of the head. Now here is the ear, by the way, and this like hair, which is like faded hair, and it like goes around. And I can wrap it around. So in a sense, it's almost like a clothing as well. Okay, so if you just, let's say you have a cylinder And if you have like a big hair lock, like a big hair group, and you're just like shaping it out, make sure you're just like wrapping it around like a piece of clothing, you see, kind of like that. Instead of just being clothed, it will be hairs, okay? So see, like I'm wrapping it around. Make sure you're like kind of visualizing that it's like going around the cylinder, okay? Now, instead of cylinder, that will be the big head, okay? So the hair is gonna go over, okay? Yeah, we can start with something like this. And then obviously there's nothing in here. We can obviously take a little bit more time to like see where the flaws are. We can like kind of fix it up and just do some texturing on top of it, okay? But let's say we have a second layer on top and we start to like, let's say build this kind of hair, okay? So now you see like, these are like really groups of hair locks, right? That's like going back. Now this is not I would say it's not a very good reference because it's, I wanna do on top actually, a layer on top, yeah. So it's not a very good reference because it's very extreme 3-4, okay? You wanna have, at least in the beginning, you wanna have some reference which shows you it's in a 3D form, like in a more 3-4 form, not in a profile view. This is a very extreme 3-4. But you see like what's happening, I can actually imagine that it will come off like this, okay? Like in the middle, and that's why I have the center line. Center line is gonna help you a lot, like it's like where the hair, because some people have this like scalp, you know, exposed. So where the scalp actually is, you know, maybe it's in the center, maybe it's on the side. So the center line is gonna help you with it. So the hair is actually going like this, you know, in this sense. So it's in the front plane, right? It's going like this. Again, the big shape is what you want, and then start going further and further into details, okay? Not details, but like the big shapes and the second big shape and third big shapes, okay? So keep like this hierarchy in mind. All right, and you'll see like, it's actually starting to come on the sides of the hair, just like we did the last time. So see, I'm kind of shaping it out. See how that curve is working in there, just like I did there. And it's all like faded hair again. Now what? Now we have this like big hair lock. So I'm just gonna do a simple shape regarding this. Okay, again, make sure the hair is like thick enough. Okay, and it's going back, kind of like that. So see, I'm like, yeah, just like shaping it out. I always, you know, one of the artists that we didn't mention is Gibson, you know, by now. And Gibson is like doing this very amazing thing that I really love. It's called faceting, okay? So what he's doing with this like shapes, for example, like you give him a cylinder to sculpt and he's gonna do this with it, right? He's gonna like, oh, I'm just gonna like facet it out. I'm just gonna turn that into like a, let's say a low poly model, you know, of the cylinder. So basically he's like really showing us like the turning edges, okay? Like the edges is what it's showing. Again, it's kind of like a mix of line decker and the other artists that we talked about, but he's gonna do it within the shapes and he's gonna do it within the form and he's gonna do it within those lines as well, okay? Let's say if you have a shape like this, what he's gonna do is like shape it out like that, kind of like this. And you see like how we are like transforming this from this like very roundish object, you know, to this like really cut out object. Now, again, not necessarily saying that you want to get to this kind of like always, okay? But you can do that, you know, if you want to be a little bit more shapely. And then we can add some Disney here. You know, see, I have like a few broken edges because he has it. And then, yeah, the hair is like fitted out all the way to the neck. And again, don't forget about the third layer, okay? We really want that right there. Okay, and now inside of this, we can start to have like hair flocks, okay? So you see like, we can see that we can actually count them as like the four groups of hair, right? The main groups of hair. So I can just come in, right? And just say, oh, design them, kind of goes back. I'm just gonna design these two, say something like this. And goes back in there, okay? Yeah, have these like striped hair, you know? And these are not striped, but these are like the groups of hair that I'm like really focusing on. I can again go back in, I can just go with another layer, you know, on top. And it's kind of like cleaned up a little bit, like design it even better. And when I'm going to do shading on top of it, even like those strokes that I'm doing, I'm adding like shape design to it. Okay. So even make it like more shapey in sense. Okay. Or more designed, you can call it. I'm just going to like tone this in, just like show that's like the back here. Okay. All right. Let's quickly. Oh, we are actually done. you want me to do some woman as well, Mike?
Yeah. A couple of minutes, let's see you do a female hairstyle.
Yeah, so here is a female. Let's see, where's my female head? Okay, let's do this one. Really want to show you like a back hairstyle as well. So you can start with something like this, like more of a simple hair. This is not simple, but yeah, this is definitely simple than, let's say, this one, okay, right here. So let's do this one, okay? Let's try to do that one. We'll see like how to handle these like top hairs. And see what's really happening if I really want to like break it down. It's really just like this. I'll do a red on top. There's like a cap, okay, on top. Let's do take that. It's like a cap on top like this. Now there's like a ponytail that's going on in that direction. And this is like kind of scrunching up the bunch of the hair. And then like different hairs, like flowing from the top. Now see how easy it is, like once you start to actually accept it, you know, once you actually start to understand that ribbon structure, okay? That's only mentioned. And then we also saw that in line decor studies, in line decor paintings. So yeah, let's get to it. So what we're gonna do, I'm just gonna do a very simple, like straight to curve design on top, okay? So maybe I do this. So again, I'm kind of like shaping it out. And then it's locked. Okay. You see like there's a little, this little twist that's going on right there. And I can definitely show that from the shape section. In you doing the shapes, something like this, okay? So it's kind of like twisting over. And then the main shape is like, maybe the ponytail, but this ribbon right here, you know, this is like going this way, right? So let's do that first, so because that is the one like actually holding up everything. Now you see like there's a twist going on right here. And let's do that first. So there's like this twist going on right here. Yeah, I should be placing it like more onto the screen left side so my hand doesn't hide it, but no worries. It almost looks like a hairband right now. It's like a bunch. That ribbon is like a hairband for me right now. That twist, which is I'm showing right now here, and then underneath this is like all the twisting that's going on right now. See, it's actually more like this. Okay, and now you can also design this ponytail. It's also like a really strong. You can also use like a straight to curve design, you know, on top of it. To see something like this, something like that. You see how I'm like using those, okay? You can come in and say, okay, here's a straight to curve design. And you can like draw that ponytail or just kind of like goes around. And then next thing you wanna do is once you get that, okay, then you just want to have all the ribbons coming from there, okay? It's like, I'm just gonna design some flow just for the sake of time here, right? Let's design some shapes in here. It's like this. And then, yeah, just like hair flowing. Now, because this is like a different view actually, so I'm just like putting in some hairs like behind the shoulder, okay? So these hairs are like flowing behind the shoulders and that. Yeah, and this is how, you know, we'll get like all of this done. Maybe I can just like go back in there, just like design the shape better, like maybe like this. Okay, now that's actually a better shape. Yeah, and then we would come in afterwards and we can design like all those. Now in this manner, we can actually decide we want to keep that one or we don't keep that one. If it's like unnecessary, just like creating unnecessary, like hair locks that's not looking appealing in any way, then we can like hide it out. So hope you like it. Hope you like this little demo, this rough flow demos. So go for a shape, right? The biggest shape, then just like start to divide it and understand like the overlaps and the layers of the head. And you want to make sure that the hair is sitting on top of it. So you are always like keeping it, like taking the metaphor of it whole. Okay. All right. Let's conclude the stream today. Thank you guys.
All right. Thank you, Mrtunjay. Thank you everyone for joining us today. A couple of reminders again. If you like what we're teaching here, then please hit the subscribe button and share it with your friends and hit the bell for notifications. Again, if you really like what we're teaching here, then go check out drawingforce.com if you want to learn more about it. And we also offer the opportunity to actually be taught by the three of us, right? So we do have mentorship at drawingforce.com where we do mentor students in one-on-one instruction in one-hour sessions. Where we can really obviously dig into something more like hair design. But either way, we'll see you guys next Friday. Have an excellent, happy and healthy weekend, everyone. And we will see you in 7 days. Take care, guys. And thank you, Swami and Mrtunjay, again, as always.
Yes. Bye. Welcome, Mike. See you guys.
See everyone. Bye-bye.